we came to this amazing project. It's so wonderful to have great collaborators on staff here and people from my past to help put these kind of projects together. Last year we put on Le Bois Humain, and this year is Before Breakfast. While I was doing research for this show to figure out what we were going to do this year, I worked and really tried to find a comedy just to bring some levity so you all think that I'm not serious all the time. But I found that there was a little bit of a hole in the repertoire. So we have some thoughts for next year, perhaps, in filling that hole. Perhaps in a commissioned piece or something like that is my wish. So a little bit about how we came to this. Finding a project, I came across Before Breakfast, and it's based on a Eugene O'Neill play of the same title. He is just a devastating literary figure of our time, riddled with alcoholism and overly demanding father, a mother who ended up passing away from a morphine addiction. His plays in general have been somewhat autobiographical. Some things that are on Broadway right now, The Iceman Cometh, if you haven't seen it, you probably should. And his iconic piece, which is not on Broadway, but is the Long Day's Journey Into Night. That one has a lot of letters in it. So, and this as well is somewhat autobiographical too. What I found out in my research is that there is a British version of this play first, that it was heavily drawn upon as well. It was called The Stronger, and it's by Strindberg. And there's actually an opera that was done called Stronger by Weisfeld. And it is intense, just as this piece is, but in a 20th century fashion, just really all over the place locally. Was not going to do that one. But any one of you students might want to look into pieces like that for a challenge or two. Before Breakfast is written by Thomas Pasatieri, and he's a living composer. And I've been in email contact with him. It's so great to have resources like that to draw upon, because I know how hard it must be for all of you to think about bringing back Mozart or Beaumarchais, trying to contact them in some way. Way easier if they're alive. So Before Breakfast, the play, was an experiment for Eugene O'Neill. He wanted to see how long the audience would stay put during a monologue. And he actually staged himself as the offstage husband so that he could watch and see the uncomfortableness of the audience as they were sitting there for a long period of time. I read little notes about him. It was his second time that he had been in a play, and his friends actually said that was his best performance because the only thing they saw of him was his hand during the show, which didn't show much in terms of his acting capabilities. His father was a very famous actor. I believe he was the man that was known for The Count of Monte Cristo. Very, very dominating man, and had a lot of an effect on Eugene O'Neill's life. Eugene O'Neill was married three times. The first woman that he married, he had gotten pregnant, so it was a marriage of out of loyalty to having gotten this girl pregnant. She then divorced him when he was having an affair on her with this lady named Maud. And what's interesting about Maud is she was a showgirl. And why I bring that up is that in comparison from the play to the opera, and this is something really important that we need to do, what is being taken from the play? What's being added to the opera? The play is so demanding and very aggressive and very intense. I couldn't imagine standing up here for 35 minutes screaming at you, because basically that's what Charlotte does to her husband in the play. Frank Corsaro and Tom Pasatieri added some content to give the audience a chance to kind of take a collective breath. And there's this center section of the opera there that she talks about a dance marathon. In the 1920s, this was right in during the Depression, so there was no social media. These dance marathons were an opportunity for people to come see some sort of entertainment. It was also an opportunity for people that were of maybe lower class that didn't have enough money. They provided shelter and food and a place to sleep. It was interesting that they added this into the opera. So when I was reading up in this wonderful book by Dowling called Eugene O'Neill, A Life in Four Acts, again, a real living person, I wrote him an email and I said, I have this middle section for this opera and I don't see it anywhere in the play. What do you think that this has to do with Eugene O'Neill's life? He wrote back to me an unpublished paper that he had done, which I'm not allowed to share. And he mentions this wonderful, colorful character of Maud, who is a showgirl that was indeed Eugene O'Neill's cause for his first divorce. So maybe Frank Corsaro and Pasatieri drew upon this one tiny nugget of many things that had happened in Eugene O'Neill's life. We also have to be mindful about how an opera is different than a play. Charlotte in the play is, again, very intense. She was part of a movement called, what was it called? Anyway, like the Lady Warrior, the Lady Killer, the Lady Destroyer, that's what it was, Lady Destroyer. So in the opera, she's a much more sympathetic character. As opera does, it has to tell that entire story to take you all on a journey with me. If I'm only at one level for an entire time, it would be like Eugene O'Neill was sitting back here and I'd want to see how you'd want to get out of your seats and leave because it's too much. We have had a great time putting this together. It's been a labor of love, and it's so, as I said, I'm so grateful. LeAnn is an amazing collaborator, as well as Linda Brovsky, who is in the audience today, and sitting with amongst you all, so I hope I get all of my staging correct. enjoy today. Here we are in Charlotte, her apartment, which isn't that much different than my apartment in New York. We're in 1920s, Christopher Street, in the Greenwich Village in New York City. And as you might know, New York apartments are not exactly large things. So often the space, the kitchen and the living room, it's all shared. I was looking at these wonderful pictures. Sometimes there's a bathtub right in the middle of the living room because that was it. You have really one and a half rooms to deal with. There's also in New York, the Tenement Museum, another resource just to go and see. New York really hasn't changed that much in a lot of places. And it's important to take a look at these really wonderful resources while they're still there. If you haven't seen New York, it's kind of building up and these treasured tenements are soon disappearing. So thank you for coming today, and I'm grateful for the Cali School of Music for allowing and indulging me on my projects before this. Thank you. Poem of mine.